I guess real quick, the breakdown, right? So lead with the synopsis.
We're going in.
And then what? Because, I mean, the point...
I think we're leaving all this in. This is all going in.
Oh, okay.
So, the Avenue 54 Film Club review, double feature review. We doubled down.
Yeah.
Out of the Past, the absolute classic.
Yeah.
Robert Mitchum, Jane Greer, Kirk Douglas.
Amazing Kirk Douglas.
Woo!
Yeah.
Jacques Tourneau.
Mm-hmm.
Masterpiece.
Yeah, pretty much.
From 1947.
Yep.
I believe. We watched last week. And this week, we had the... I don't know what you'd call it. The
dubious honor?
The regrettable pleasure of watching the remake, the 84 of Against All Odds.
Yes.
Which is sort of a remake.
It's sort of a loose adaptation. Maybe not loose. It's not a strident adaptation. It's not a loose adaptation. It kind of falls sort of somewhere in the middle. And then we're left with these, I don't know, kind of just questionable choices as to, you know, decision making as to even why remake this movie.
Yeah. I think it's a common opinion that when you have a classic film, like an absolute outright classic,
yeah,
don't touch it, you know,
right?
And then it's done over and over and over again.
Yeah.
Directors go, no.
No.
We're going to touch it.
Yeah.
And every once in a while, something at the very least interesting comes out of touching a classic.
Sure.
You know?
Sure.
I don't think that's the case here.
Not really. No. No.
So let's talk about Out of the Past first. Okay. So we did a shot for shot 2-hour review of Out of the Past last week, right after we watched it when it was very fresh in our minds.
Yeah.
And there were technical difficulties.
I think so. Yes.
So,
and we were rendered mutes from last week, apparently.
Right. So this is the redo of that review.
Yeah. Yeah.
So Mitchum, the plot is basically, the synopsis of the story is, Mitchum's a dick, an ex-dick.
Yes.
Living in small town California.
Yep.
Gas station attendant, and guy in a suit shows up.
Yep.
Look, kind of feels and looks like a hood.
Dude from out of his past.
And
show immediately.
And says, hey, bud.
Yeah.
There's, you know, you remember the guy. You should go see him.
Yeah.
And turns out, you know, Mitchum has some, he has some debts owed.
Yeah.
He goes and picks up his girl.
His current girlfriend.
His current girlfriend in small town California. Mm-hmm. And just
spills the beans.
It feels like he's got to spill them.
Yeah.
And as he starts telling her that he's first... My name is not
I'm not even Jeff Bailey.
I'm not even Jeff Bailey.
I'm Jeff Markle.
My name's not even my name.
Yeah,
is how he starts.
Not even my name.
That's not even my real name.
That actually goes over pretty well.
It
given
does.
Given the circumstance. She's kind of like, okay, tell me more.
Right.
Wait, is your first name at least Jeff?
Yes.
I think you're something like that.
I don't know if
he's
she
like,
does.
Yeah, you're
but
Jeff.
I don't remember there being much of a reaction.
No.
And then he goes into telling the story from his past. Right.
Right.
And there was a time when he was hired to go, you know, find a dame, trail a dame, who shot the boss.
Yep.
And hightailed it with 40 grand.
With 40,000 of his money.
Right.
To where else? Mexico.
We're in
California. So we dipped to Mexico.
Can you go find her?
Yeah.
I won't hurt her.
Uh-huh.
I just want her back.
Yeah.
Right.
And we believe him. and everything. And it's kind of, it's a sincere sort of thing that we're up into, up until this point of the movie.
And as you can imagine, in a dick story of the day, a noir dick story, things go awry.
Sure.
You know, and there's a lot of twists and turns that take Markham slash Bailey down all these avenues with shady characters, femme fatales.
Sure. Ex-business partners.
Ex-business partners.
The new bosses, hood right men, like all the things. You're just you're thrown all into all of the trappings. You get all of the stuff and you get it packaged in this just like beautifully presented aesthetic. You know what I mean? Like,
yes. Which leads us to him having to basically flee the scene, set up a new life, change his name in small town America.
Yep.
And he's basically in hiding when we find him in the beginning because of all of these twists and turns and craziness from his past.
Not the least of which is this woman that he was in love with.
Yes.
That is the boss's squeeze girlfriend, whatever it is. You know, they have a relationship.
And that's basically the synopsis of the story.
Yeah.
So,
and it's cool that it's kind of told in this flashback. You know, you get the first, I mean, with the exception of the first 5 minutes, that introduction and then the car ride, the next 20 minutes of the movie, the car ride from presumably her house to the boss's house.
Yep.
Told in flashback.
Yeah.
And we're in Mexico and we get this cool story and we see the, you know, you see the emotions develop between the two characters.
Totally.
Yeah.
Yeah. So what I'd say first before spoilers, that's the basic synopsis.
Right.
I absolutely adore the film.
Completely.
I love it.
Yeah.
It's shot beautifully. It's acted like above and beyond by basically every character. Yeah. So all the supporting characters, there's only maybe Jim the simp.
Oh yeah. Jimp.
He's just Jimp. Jimp is like,
dubbed him Jimp.
Yeah, Jimp is aight.
Yeah.
He's aight.
Services what he needs to service in terms of the film.
Sure.
Yeah.
Sure. And you know, Joe the henchman he's a little over the top.
Yeah, he was at not times the greatest actor maybe, but his role was
But our primaries, killing it.
Phenomenal.
Killing
all
it.
Three. All Robert three principals.
Mitchum, you know, the man, the myth, the legend is absolutely incredible.
Pretty much just perfect.
Right? Yeah.
You know? And he does so with just this, like, you know, this smooth, laconic, you know, not really bothered by whatever it is that's going around him. Like, he just plays this character and has this thing with him the entire time that's like, you know, it's a bit anti what we, you know, have come to associate, I think, Lee Dix of the day with, you know, like Humphrey Bogart and shit like that.
I think there's a similar, you know, bravado that like Bogart has in his roles in some ways, but Mitchum just has a singular identity in the way that he carries that same sort of leading man performance.
Yeah.
And, you know, I think a big part of it starts like physically. He just looks,
he's imposing.
Yeah. He's big. Like, he's a big guy. But he also has like a weird doughy kind of face. Like, I think I was telling you when we were watching it, like, it almost looks like he has Down syndrome in a way.
Yeah.
Like, he has a weird, like, spread apart eyes.
Yes.
But at the same
chin
time,
comes down to that weird point. Yeah.
He's
totally
dreamy. He's about as dreamy as they get.
100%.
Yeah. So,
and the trench coat is on and the hat and what, and you're just like, okay, I'm buying it. Selling me right now?
Yeah, just from an aesthetic angle, like him as an actor, but also obviously the film, like the way the film's shot and the direction. I think we had noticed that. So wait, before we get into some of the minutia, I would say 100% if you have not seen this film, I highly recommend you go see this film.
Yeah.
Go see this film.
I think this kind of would fall into any sort of like film 101 curriculum. Like you would cover Out of the Past when you're in the, you know, 40s film noir.
Sure.
Part of the subject matter of your class. Like it's up there.
Yeah. I think if anybody's talking about film noir,
yeah, you're going to mention this.
This
movie.
Is like top 10 material for sure. Right, yeah. So definitely go see the film. Highly recommend it.
Yeah.
Now back to, I think we were noticing there's not a lot of like, really unique, camera techniques in like mostly it seemed like it was static, you know, tripod shots or like, you know,
lots of panning of the camera, moves like that for sure. Exactly. No dolly tracks laid down. You know what I mean? There was nothing too inventive or like overarching technically, It was presented very matter of fact.
Yeah.
You know,
I didn't see or notice a lot of like crane stuff or anything like that, but everything looked pretty goddamn gorgeous.
Yeah, it was perfect.
And you did get like quite a few of those like just classic Tinseltown, you know, perfect silhouette shots with the light just dripping off of the edges of their faces
and the
as
rooms
they're about to embrace in the hallway.
Rooms are full of smoke also.
Oh yeah, so much cigarette smoke.
So I don't know if I've seen a movie that has more cigarette smoke in it.
Yeah. If Philip Morris didn't pay them this film,
I think it was Chesterfield. Yeah. At least there was a shot at one of a Chesterfield on a pack. Right. So whoever owned maybe it was Philip Morris.
Yeah.
I don't know.
And I think there might even have been a mention of Chesterfield.
Yeah. Yeah. They did definitely. They had their hand in this pot for sure. Yeah.
Okay. Acting great. Jane Greer was incredible.
Phenomenal.
I love the dimensional female character.
Yeah.
You know, I feel like, you know, even today, this would be quite progressive part for a female who shares a ton of the screen time and does have a very dimensional character and then is acted with a lot of intricacy in terms of, is she good? Is she bad? Is she in love? Is she playing him? Is she, you know, what are her motivations?
Yeah.
What's going on here? And she really drives the story.
She does. She drives all of the action.
Yeah.
You know, where's Kathy Moffitt?
Right. And even like what she does off screen, because you're launched into the story of her shooting her boyfriend, the Kirk Douglas boss character.
That's
What's his name?
Oh, it was...
I can't remember.
Oh, goodness.
Yeah. Damn it.
If only this was last week. Eels. No, Eels was the lawyer.
No, Eels was the lawyer, yeah.
He had a great character. His character's name was great.
Too. Yeah, I know. It was like Kirk or... It wasn't, because that's his fucking real name.
It'll come to us. It'll come to us.
But anyways, she shot him.
Yeah.
She shot him.
Right, so her presence looms large far before we even see her.
Right.
You know, and we're set up with this, like you said, you know? What are the intentions of this character, you know? Yeah. Like, how ambiguous... It's just ambiguous out the gate. You don't know what, because then by the time you first see her in Mexico, she is, you know, a little bit disinterested. She's both. She's constantly saddling the line, right? Of, like, affected and, like, disaffected, you know? Interested, not interested. In love, take them or leave them. You know?
Yeah.
And it's excellent. It's a testament to the writing. And then obviously the dimensions and the element that she brought to it, you know, from like acting this performance. It's
totally,
so good.
Totally.
And it really is. It's a massive role in a massive character.
I feel like they treated the audience with respect with the intelligent writing and the performances and all that stuff. And I think one of the things we were talking about was, you know, every time I kind of had a question where I was like, oh, why would they do that? Then they would give me some explanation as to why.
And it would be like the following scene or so.
Exactly.
You know? There was no fat on this movie.
Right.
You know?
Right.
The pacing was amazing.
Yes.
and there was nothing superfluous. You know, it was all driving. It was all action driven. You know,
even for like in the third act, the plot does get kind of convoluted. We add
it gets a tricky. Lot of,
it get maybe convoluted's got negative connotation.
Yeah,
it gets complex.
It does,
and
because there's introduction of like a couple of new characters.
Yes,
right. The club owner.
Right.
You know.
Yeah.
The lawyer.
And we're going back and forth and back and forth. The secretary.
True. Yeah.
You know, and we're doing a lot of like, let's jump from this location to that mm-hmm. location, mm-hmm. and now there's a new directive for our guy to follow so
yeah.
that he can tie this thing up. And now there's new, you know, intention that the boss is trying to throw his way so he could
totally.
Continue his scheme, and new ways for Bailey to thwart it.
Because, yeah, because everything at this point in the movie has been a lead up to these series of crosses and then double crosses.
Yeah. Oh, you know? Yeah, that's right. So we counted something like...
There's like eight crosses.
I think
we included yeah. five doubles,
yeah.
three regulars. Right. I mean, it was right. just wild. And yeah, it gets complex. I mean, it's a web. It's just, you know, we're thrust into this web of intrigue.
Yes.
You know?
Yep.
And everybody's out to essentially, you know... get each other, you know?
Yeah. And so it, you know, in the review, maybe what we did before, and I don't love so much in a lot of reviews
yeah.
is, you know, we're not going to go through the entire plot of the whole movie and a scene for scene.
Right.
Because then you don't have to go watch the movie.
Totally.
Or if you do go watch the movie and you never saw it, but you watched this review of it, we're going to kind of fucking ruin it for you.
Completely.
So I don't want to give you all the twists and turns
because yeah.
it's great. Because even I had seen this movie maybe three times before we rewatched it last week. And when we rewatched it, a lot of the plot was fresh for me.
Same here.
Like it,
same here.
You know,
there's a lot to follow there.
Yeah.
Once we get into act two.
And I was still pretty hooked
yeah.
in there. So
uh-huh.
I want that for you.
Yes.
I want you to have that experience if you are rewatching or watching this classic for the first time.
I mean, in rewatching it, I felt like part of me was watching it for the first time.
Yeah,
like
sure.
I got to take the clothes off of the, you know, out of the past for the first time again.
Yeah.
It's yeah, pretty phenomenal stuff.
It really is a great movie. There
uh-huh.
were I think a couple logic pieces that I struggled with. Jim the Simp was, you know,
I think we
I'm gonna go on the tail
we
with
settled
the,
on the Fish and Wildlife, right? He's with the Game Commission or something,
which I think is fair for us to do to decide what his position is.
Sure,
because he has like a California state
yeah.
vehicle.
Yeah.
It has like the
yeah, there was an emblem on it for sure.
Right, but not a
not
sheriff
AAA.
Or not a
Nuh-uh.
Yeah. So it's up to us
yeah.
to decide what his actual
yeah.
city job is,
yeah.
but it's a little confusing.
He had park ranger vibes like for days. Okay.
Yeah, exactly. He does. And yeah, and poor, what is her name? What's the girlfriend's name?
Was it
Anne?
Anne, I think it was Anne.
Is it? It's Anne.
Yeah.
Okay.
Played by
that reminds me of like Arrested Development, you know, the girlfriend, his girlfriend in that, her name's Anne and they always call her Bland.
Yes,
because she's just whatever,
forgettable.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which Anne is kind of
a little bit
she's a little forgettable.
Yeah,
but not
her
bad,
moment in the twigs. I mean, yeah.
So there's that
brush,
right? These are a few things.
I mean, very, very few. I think we're also completely nitpicking.
Yeah. She's but, laying in dry brush.
Yeah, that was a strange
at the edge
choice.
Of a
like a stream,
a stream
yeah.
that's like a dead stream. It's an odd place.
It's a very strange
to
decision.
Do that. But you know what? Now that I say it,
uh-huh.
1947,
yeah.
small town, California.
Where else are you going to kick it?
I mean, no phones, no.
Nah.
You know, there's not, you
uh-uh.
know what I mean? You're stressed.
Yeah.
Maybe there's a little stream out in the back.
See?
Yeah.
The decision seems less strange now.
It did seem like whoever was setting the shot up thought that was the right place to put the camera because
yeah.
it looked right, but it didn't look right.
It did. Yeah, it honestly just like didn't.
Anyways.
Yeah.
So yeah, it was small stuff like that. There's like taking files out of the office of mm-hmm. the club, and there's like goons in the hallway.
And the goons kind of like, let him go.
Yeah, they're like, "Where are you going?" He's like, "Don't worry about it.
Yeah, I'm out.
Handled it.
Yeah,
you know." And they're like, "Okay, no worries."
I mean, yeah, I know that one is a little weird, but then you also just kind of have to attribute goons have just a lesser intelligence, right? So they just bought it out the gate.
You're selling me, dude. Okay. You're selling me.
Okay,
you're selling me because they'd be in a higher position in the organization
if they were not. Yeah,
if they were,
if they had intelligence,
higher intelligence, yeah. they wouldn't be goons.
That's right, dude. That's Damn. Right. They would be the account. They would be the accountants or the.
You know what? Know. It's quite possible that Mr. Torno left no stone unturned.
Seriously, and
left no element of this film unthought about
yeah.
thoroughly.
Right.
Yeah.
Which makes it seriously, which yeah. makes it even more impressive because I feel yeah. like there was such an economy to pace with this movie too. Right. It felt so, it was like a professional job, you
for
know,
sure.
You
for
know
sure.
what I mean?
And for so many maneuvers through the plot.
Oh my God.
Like that is a difficult job. And like this one takes so many turns.
Yeah.
And yeah, I do feel like it's handled by a consummate pro.
100%.
The entire time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
In stark contrast to the chunk we just watched.
This yeah. This
But maybe this is too early for a segue into Against All Odds.
What I'd say is I think just like Against All Odds makes Out of the Past look like the best film ever made.
Yeah.
Out of the Past makes Against All Odds look like the worst film ever made.
I mean, yeah.
They both have that effect on each other.
For sure.
And like, you know, in true noir fashion, the shadow of Out of the Past.
Well put, my friend.
Is so heavily cast.
Yeah.
Over anybody's idea of trying to do a remake, that Against All Odds was working against all odds to make to
yeah,
make a
against
good
all
remake.
Odds, it's a pretty appropriate title. It was against all odds that this was going to go over well with audiences. It was against all odds that audiences would be able to follow this plot
and be worth making
for sure,
and just for sure. be worth making in general.
God, we just took like a giant shit on Against All Odds.
Well, so, all right. So I'd say out of 10, we usually, for the film club, we usually do a rating similar to like IMDb. So like 0 to 10, I'd give Out of the Past like, God, I'd give it like a 8.5 or so.
Yeah, I'm with you.
You know,
I'm in that 9 zone. Like, yeah, I just don't see too much stuff that you can, like, what are you going to dock?
I think there's those couple weak characters. Oh, and then what we were saying, or what I was saying, is the conclusion to the Kirk Douglas boss character sort of turning on a dime.
Yeah.
To all of a sudden go against Kathy at the end.
Right.
And try to set her up based on some loose information that is given to him that doesn't really seem like it changes everything or it should change everything, right. And then all of a sudden he's like, you know, he's been this ride or die bitch for his chick, like he's been in the face of her shooting him robbing him and still super in love and down to pick up and move forward, and then the info that he's given
weren't buying that it was just like enough to sway him at this point.
Right.
You know?
To just completely, you know, 180 his position.
It's a valid point because I think also, you know, what we've been setting up up until this point in the story is that like actually the dude, his loyalties are kind of like unchallenged. Like we kind of know where this dude's, he's a pretty loyal dude. Shot, robbed, and he's still down.
Well, I don't know if I'd go so far as to say loyal. It seems like his entire character is based on ego and his it, like what drives him and every decision he makes is about his base pleasures and desires, but really about winning, because he's a gambler at heart and he has to win. And this is this relationship with this femme fatale is like one of the places, one of the only places in his life where he didn't
where he's
win.
Not winning. Right.
So he was willing to do, he was willing to go against all odds.
Yeah. Yeah.
to try to rectify the one time he lost. And I, but I really think it was about his, I can't lose.
Yeah.
Like,
which we saw in the Jeff Bridges character.
Yeah.
They literally grafted that character trait from the Kirk Douglas character and put it onto the Jeff Bridges character.
Right. So with that said, so you'd sold me on a bunch of the things I have problems with in the past as being, you know, I think I sold myself on the dry brush. Laying.
Yes, you did. You did. That and was a job
sold,
well done.
You sold me on the goons being goons. So they're goons.
That's it.
Goons are going to be goons.
That's
you know?
Yeah.
And then, but that Kirk Douglas bit, that 180 at the end.
Yeah.
Man. Yeah.
I wish I could sell you.
But I won't say any more because that is a little bit of a spoiler, but there's still... Even with everything that we said about Out of the Past, you're going to enjoy the hell out of it.
There's so much meat and potatoes there on that movie.
And there's still the ending. Ugh.
I know. I know. And you know what? We talked about the, you know, this amazing performance from Mitchum and from Jane Greer.
Yeah.
Can't go without mention how amazing Kirk Douglas was in just his third film role.
Right.
You know?
Right.
This dude was so polished. He was so suave.
Yeah. He carries that sinister,
it's
that
just
like
perfect.
Joyfully sinister looming threat throughout the film in such a like elegant way.
Elegant.
It's like
you know, completely, dude.
You
the first time you feel it in that room in the Mitchum's hotel room in Mexico.
Yeah.
And then it just carries on through the rest of the picture. It's so good.
Yeah. It's great. All right. So that's
I'm gonna run a 9.
With the 180 I go remember.
Yeah.
A 10 is a perfect film.
Right. And I guess I'm looking at it in terms of like okay, like where does it fit like in historical context and like genre context, right? Mm-hmm. Like it's a pretty stellar example of these genre films that we love, right? Of like film noir.
No,
right?
That's true. And if I put it next to The Big Sleep, Maltese Falcon, Murder My Sweet, Kiss Me Deadly.
Yeah, other amazing stories from the same genre.
They've got flaws.
Those films.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They've got flaws.
I'm Big Sleep's pretty, I mean, I have seen it 20 times. Yeah. I still don't know what the plot, I can't tell you the plot.
Exactly.
You know? I don't know.
That's my point.
For all of its convolution, it might be spot on. It might be perfect.
That's what
I don't
I'm
know.
Saying.
But
I'm
can't
saying
follow it.
Even films that are as good as this one in the genre have flaws that are equal to or greater than this film has. So, all right, I'll hold firm, even with my, I don't understand the 180 motivations for the, you know, heavies switch at the end.
Yeah.
Which is kind of an important thing to me.
I'll hold
firm at my 8.5.
All right. That's, I mean, still a solid rating.
8.5.
That's
a
solid
and a 9.
Rating. Yeah.
Go fucking see it, dude.
Yeah, please just go see it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, you can stream it somewhere. I had a DVD, but you can go stream it somewhere.
Completely.
Yeah.
Completely. I mean, clearly it's one of the ones that has resonated. I think it's still spoken about in classes. It's still probably taught about, lectured about, screened at revival houses across the country and God knows where else. Like, and then remade almost 40 years later.
All right. So I almost don't even want to talk about this movie.
Damn. I mean... I think in us talking about it, I think we'll be able to mine something decent out of it.
Okay, all right.
I'm going into this thing optimistic.
1984's Against All Odds.
Yes.
We just watched it. Mm-hmm. It's a Taylor Hackford joint.
Mm-hmm. Not too much else, I think, like stellar on the bill of like credits, right? Like I didn't know the
director,
writer, photographer.
The writer had done.
Yeah, you knew a little something about the writer.
The writer wrote this, And then you know what he wrote that they did that he did together with Taylor? I'm first name basis clearly. At this point. I mean, clearly. After watching Against All, I'm like one of eight people who watched this film and actually like thought about it.
Yeah.
We deserve to be on a first name basis. They did some movie together with Mikhail Baryshnikov and Gregory Hines.
Oh, I like vaguely remember that. Like, I'm talking as a child, seeing like a poster at like the movie rental store, you know?
And being like, what?
Yeah,
like,
what?
Isn't that guy like a famous Russian ballet dancer or something?
Yeah.
And they paired him with
famous American dancer.
Tap dancer.
Yeah.
Which, what's the name of that one? Where he's like, that's like a neo-noir film.
Wasn't Bojangles, was it?
No. I think it's called Tap. Tap.
I think you're right.
And like, and there's all these badass tap dance sequences of Gregory Hines in the studio.
And it's like a noir?
I remember it having like a noir look to it. And he's like down on his luck and used to have a tap career and he's got to find a way to get over. And there's like a crime element to it. I haven't seen it since I was 8 years old.
But. I mean, I think we just found our follow-up to this movie review. We're going to watch Tap.
The one with Billy Crystal's great.
Billy Crystal and Gregory Hines.
Yes. It's like a fucking buddy cop movie.
Buddy cop.
It's great.
Yeah.
Anyways. Okay. So he wrote that. Wrote this. And then he wrote some other dud.
Well, that's a pretty quick succession, right? Because Tap was like probably, what, 86, 7, 8? No, somewhere he didn't write there.
Tap. I went off on a tangent. Oh, okay, Tap. Okay. That's what I know of Gregory Hines.
I see.
He wrote this Mikhail Baryshnikov and Gregory Hines vehicle.
Oh, yeah.
Which I didn't even read what the plot was. Yeah. I just thought that was interesting.
Yeah, you and, you know, everybody else. Like, okay, buddy, I think your turn's done here.
He has three films on his writing.
You know what, though? That's a hell of an accomplishment.
It is.
Like, I don't care if you turn in junk. You got three things made by a Hollywood production studio. Yeah.
I have zero films with a Greek god looking Jeff Bridges and fucking prime time James Woods.
Yeah. White pants wearing, Ferrari driving, aviator rocking, volleyball playing. Stabbed in the dick.
James fucking Woods, dude.
Yeah, he's phenomenal.
I have written zero pieces that have drawn any interest from those two talented motherfuckers in their goddamn prime.
Yeah, seriously, distracting how attractive Jeff Bridges is in this movie.
It's tough,
like,
dude.
Fuck, dude.
It's tough. Who would have thought?
I don't even know what Paul Newman in Venice in like the mid-60s vibes with the beard and the slick back blonde hair and shit. Like,
there's something going on with the piercing blue eyes and the blonde. He's got like the blonde tips.
Yeah,
you know?
It's like a blend,
but it looks natural.
Sun bleached, you know? Oh. Careless, carefree.
Jesus Christ, dude.
Yeah, that was definitely the high point of the movie.
And so I think we came up with an idea for how this film came about, and I think it was so in the film there's a shady lawyer played by, I believe the actor's name is Saul Rubinek.
Okay.
And he plays the director in True Romance, who's coked out of his fucking mind talking about how he's going to make his next war epic. And coming home in a body bag.
Yeah.
Coming home in a body bag is the name of his film in that. But he's coked out of his mind. He's talking about, you know, how it's the only real war movie ever made and all this kind of shit. I think something similar was going on with Taylor Hackford.
Yeah, I think you're onto something.
The writer who's got the three credits.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure they were at a party in the 80s, early 80s, getting coked out of their fucking minds. And somebody brought up Out of the Past.
Dude, I love that movie.
Fuck it. You know what?
Let's fucking.
You know what? You know what? This is like.
Let's rewrite it.
You know what? A modern version of Out of the Past, but instead of a dick,
Yeah.
He's a pro football player.
I know. Like,
who's got a gambling debt?
He was throwing games. So they had evidence on him
that he threw
a professional football game.
That's right. That's
in order
right.
for the James Woods character, Palace, right. Jake Palace.
That's right.
To
that's
whatever, right. place his bets on the game and make a bunch of money.
But so instead of a dick, he's a pro football player.
Yeah.
Who's recently been injured and is fired from his job.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that's how he's put in the jackpot to go find the daughter of the
daughter of the owner
of the millionaire of the owner,
played by Jane Greer.
Yeah. By the original Kathy Moffat.
Yeah. Which is kind of sick.
It's great.
Like, that's cool that happened. No doubt.
I think also Jane Greer was, she, because David Lynch loved Out of the Past so much, she was a reoccurring character on Twin Peaks.
Oh, that's very sick.
She was like the diner owner, her mother, I believe.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So anyways, he stuck Jane Greer in there, but we're going to.
Right. So
instead of a dick, he's a pro football player
who
just got fired and injured. And
for like concealing his injuries, right? Like there's like a little controversy around that too. Are you playing injured? You shouldn't be playing injured. Knowing that if your employer finds out that you're injured and you're playing injured, they can cancel your contract without having to pay you.
Right.
And that's where this character is left in this limbo of, well, fuck, I'm going to be out of a job. They found out that I'm actually hurt when I said that I'm fine.
Yeah.
And this is also the 80s, and this is before all of this intense sports medicine. And it's just kind of like, you look hurt. Okay, you're hurt, and we're going to fucking clip your contract. And that's that, dude.
But where we get this beautiful opening sequence of the hood arrives in the little town and he goes to the diner
and out of the
and
past.
We meet middle America and he does this veiled threat.
And those contrasts off the bat, you know, of just this like sinister fucking looking dude showing up in this very just like, you know.
Well, and this is a beautiful setup of that whole thing leading into him getting in the car with his then girlfriend and going into this flashback sequence of what really happened.
Yeah.
And his motivation for that being, I'm going to come clean with the now real love of my life. So that opening, just gorgeous. It makes perfect sense.
Yeah, it's beautiful. Yeah.
So here we're just on the hunt for
immediately
the missing girl.
We're in Mexico.
We
open in
Mexico. That's how we open.
Yeah, we open in Mexico.
And then I think he's just chilling, thinking. Is he just thinking?
He's just like,
walking around
town asking people if they've seen, have you seen this mujer?
So when we get to then we flash back to the football. Then all of a sudden he's on the field.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I think he's just chilling, thinking. He's just doing a little.
That was weird. Little, he was like nodding off at the table, and then we're at football practice in El Segundo. Exactly. It's just like, huh?
So like the contrast of, I think the contrast of the two openings is like a perfect.
Yeah, I think so too.
Like it exemplifies the difference in these two films.
Yeah.
And within the first 5 minutes, as soon as you get to the flashback into the football sequence, you immediately get a really bad
acting
performance
from that coach.
Their version of Out of the Past is, you know, what's coming out of Jeff Bridges' past is all this disgruntled history as a football player. And again, the assistant coach or the trainer's disgruntled past with the football, and then the mismanagement of the team.
Yeah, this is
that's what's coming out of his past.
Yeah,
You know, that's really traumatic for him.
It's, so we have employees that are bummed out at work. That's basically what went on here.
You got disgruntled employees at the base of it, and then you do have some some cheating going on.
Yeah, so that's true. Yeah, there's that level of intrigue.
You know, cheating in professional sports. The team is the Executioners or the, what is it?
Outlaws.
The Outlaws. Yeah. The Los Angeles Outlaws.
What NFL team would want to associate themselves with cheating, murder?
That's true. That's what the problem. They probably had the Raiders on board in the beginning.
Yeah.
And then
the NFL was probably like,
they were like,
no, we can have
nothing to do with this film at all.
Yeah.
You're going to have to change the name. It, like,
They didn't get NFL licensing.
They probably That's why they had to make all of that. And maybe that was the impetus for them doing basically the whole movie in ADR. All of the ADR stuff, too, felt like they needed some of it for certain things.
And then when they got in there, or whatever. Yeah.
They were just like, oh, well, let's touch this part. Oh, we can make the movie so much better by adding ADR everywhere.
Yeah, no, don't.
So let's go for the good, okay?
Yeah.
Jeff Bridges, gorgeous.
God. Gorgeous. Yeah, really, godlike.
Shirt off.
Yeah, half the movie shirt off. Yeah.
James Woods, he's fun.
He's fine.
He's having some fun.
Yeah.
You know, you get some classic James Woods delivery, the racing scene. There's a racing sequence in the beginning between a Ferrari and a Porsche. James Woods and
Jeff Bridges
racing a Porsche down Sunset?
Sunset Bully, baby.
Yeah. That was not a bad race sequence.
That was a good technical feat. Yeah, they pulled that off.
High tension. Yeah. So that's not bad.
Yeah, and the shot selection was good, and then the cars are fucking beautiful.
Yes. So that's a good sequence.
Yeah. A 308 and a 911 maybe. Yeah. 911 Targa. It was a convertible. It didn't have a top, so I don't know what model that is. But it was red.
It was red and fucking beautiful. Yeah. They were both gorgeous cars, and it did look realistically like they were going very fast and doing very dangerous maneuvers
in real traffic. Right around UCLA. Yeah, it was very cool. Like. Yeah.
So that's another high part.
Yeah. Yep. High point.
Wait. You get a so bad it's good sex scene. At the ancient ruins in Tulum. Is it Tulum? No, where are they?
They were in
somewhere in Mexico.
Chichen Itza. Which I think is like right there. It's right there on that Yucatan Peninsula. It's all that Mayan ruins shit.
Yes. You also get some so bad it's good. You know, the first kiss is immediately cut to them snorkeling underwater with full like face gear.
Yeah, that was amazing. And the snorkel, dude.
And, wow. Like, wrapping around each other in the water. It's hilarious. It's very, very funny. So it's so bad it's good.
Yeah, very strange decisions and made. And
then so bad it's good to go have a hot,
full, tanned, steamy,
tanned, oily,
yes, sweaty,
sex scene inside of one of the ancient one of the ruined temples. Sites.
Yeah, it was incredible.
During the day, there's tourists rolling around everywhere.
Yeah, and surprise.
They're interrupted.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's a so bad it's good.
Totally. Good call.
And then you're pretty much at the end of the movie before something good happens again or something like worthwhile.
Kid Creole, dog.
Kid Creole and the coconuts.
Yeah. What the fuck?
There's a sequence towards the end where we're at James Woods Club.
The Palace.
Which is the Palace.
It is called the Palace in the movie. It is actually the Palace.
It's the Palace.
We grew up going there.
Palace in Hollywood.
Famous nightclub on Vine, yeah.
And across James from Capitol Woods Records. Introduces
his big act for the night.
Has a pretty funny little, tries to make a joke.
Yeah, it's he not does.
Funny.
Yeah, MC style. Yeah.
I was never a comedian. Blah, blah, blah. Let me introduce to you. The tropical gangsters,
Kid Creole and the coconuts. Yeah,
and then you get a pretty beautiful open of Kid Creole,
in full zoot suit regalia.
Bad ADR again on him doing the song, in zoot suit, and then his backup dancers, all three in gold sequined dresses, two piece dresses, all with thick armpit hair.
Amazing.
Got all three of them to have thick armpit hair. I guess that's the tropical part.
I'm assuming so. Yeah, that's I'm assuming that
was a tie-in to them being tropical. It must be gangsters.
Yeah, they're really going for it.
I wonder whose choice that was.
Probably Kid Creole's.
It was one of the best choices made in the filming of this movie.
Just keep.
Because the when underhand. I saw it, the I got hand. Very happy.
Yeah, that excited. Was dope.
It was one of the most interesting.
And they are rocking it too. It's showcased. Their hands are up and down. It's part of the show. You know,
the girls want you to see. Kid Creole wants you to see. The filmmakers want you to see. It's an important part of what's going on. So that sequence is great. Yeah, doesn't last long enough.
No, yeah.
I was so seriously checked out at that point.
Give me a show at this point, dude. Just take the intermission.
Like, give me a full four minutes.
Yeah,
and
that's
we
right.
did come to find out that I think that is actually the name of his band, Kid Creole and
it
the
is.
Coconuts.
Yeah.
And I think that is actually one of their songs off of one of their albums.
That's so sick.
And their third studio album is called Tropical Gangsters.
Tropical Gangsters, yeah. I know. Pretty dope.
So it was sort of like a showcase piece that was plugged into the film, which was probably like a partnership with Atlantic or whoever the label was, I would imagine.
This movie charted a number one single. And it was that Phil Collins song, Against All Odds.
And it must have been part of the soundtrack, right?
Yeah.
So he actually made the song for this film?
Made the song for the movie.
All right. So that's the purpose of this movie.
Is to showcase this Phil Collins joint?
Well, or to get him to create this lovely piece of music that went on to change lives and probably...
Take a look at me now. Exactly. It's a fucking amazing song. It's so good.
That was not made for a solo album. It was made for the movie
because the name of the song is is Against All Odds, and then I think it's in quotations, Take a Look at Me Now. Okay. Or the other way around.
Well, if that's the case, if this movie was what prompted Phil Collins to write that beautiful piece of music, I mean, just think
I don't know what movie he watched.
Even if it was just a business deal, where they were like, "Hey, Phil, we need a song," and he was like, "All right,
cool,"
and then he came up with that.
Yeah,
just think about how many children were born listening to that song.
Seriously.
In the 80s.
That was a huge hit.
That song...
Huge hit. It was number one. Billboard number one.
That song wet quite a few dicks.
Yeah, dude. No doubt, dude. No doubt. And we only get it, you know, we only get it at the end of the movie, too.
All the way at the end.
Yeah. Literally, the credits.
Yeah, so we've got the Kid Creole big band, Kid Creole and the Coconuts big band sequence.
So what we're listing
not long
off,
enough.
No, it's not.
Not long
it's
enough.
Not.
And the armpit backup dancers. And then you get a kind of cool break into the lawyer's office sequence where I just noticed the music was cool.
Music was
the
cool.
The pulling.
Yeah.
You know, when he gets in there.
It's low lit in shadow.
Exactly.
It's like
you get more
just,
of like
there's
a
vibe.
Neo-noir.
There's an atmospheric fucking vibe to that thing. Yeah, for sure.
But then,
imminent danger because, you know, it's like, okay, this is not going to go well.
Yeah. But it goes south pretty quick.
Yeah.
Then you get a so bad it's good sequence where he forces the secretary to go in and get the missing files.
Yeah.
And there's the security guard drinking champagne with a Rottweiler at the desk. While his guys go search for the missing dead body in the building.
Oh, man. Yeah, and it doesn't really look like he's doing a whole hell of a lot of searching either. He's just enjoying his Krug or his Brute or whatever it is he's sipping.
While the rest of my fake security team, because she even says, like, you're not a security guard.
Yeah.
I'm supposed to be here.
Yeah.
So the fake security team searches for a missing corpse in this office building, in this lawyer's office building.
Yeah.
Your best thinking was, I'm going to post up with the Rottweiler.
Post up with the dog.
Have a little bit of sham.
Yeah. While I got my goons out on the case, dude. Things are good.
And I'm watching the secret files.
Yeah.
But when a random person walks in that I don't know, who says they're a secretary and was sent by the boss to get the files that I'm looking for and or protecting.
Yeah. I just
no
go,
problem.
Okay, cool. I've had it.
Let me put the dog in the bathroom for you.
I'll even do you the favor. She said, literally. Yeah, that scene. Oh, man.
So then just everything else is just, it's so bad, it's good for sure.
That was great. That was a lot of fun. That was fun revisiting that scene.
When Uncle Ben steps on the scene, he's a little, or Godfather Ben.
Yeah,
or
Godfather,
whatever.
Yeah.
He's a little fun. He gets some.
He's fun. He's got some good. He's got some great delivery of some pretty mediocre lines.
Yeah.
Thinking about it, throwing around those, like, you know, sitting the asshole sitting next to you. It's like,
yeah.
He delivered that line great.
Yeah.
You know, Richard Widmark. It was a, you know, 40s, 50s.
Oh, yeah.
Heavy
he's a G.
type. Yeah. He's
yeah.
a G.
He's a
yeah.
G. And he comes from those kind of movies.
He does.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I'm trying to think. I know. Yeah, I'm going to look it up after. He was in a ton of good
ones. Ton of stuff. Yeah.
Good noir films.
Yeah. Yeah.
So that was probably intentional, obviously.
Yeah.
Okay, the last two things I'll say about what I like is, and I think these are so bad it's good and not intentionally fantastic, is he gets his director credit over the Mexican xylophone team.
Like five of them on one
so they have
L-shaped xylophone.
While they're xylophoning out, directed by Taylor Hackford, laid over.
Right.
Nice. Very, very nice touch.
Yeah, that was a nice touch.
Very classy.
Yeah.
And then the closeout, knowing you have this piece of music history in your hands.
Seriously.
With this Phil Collins just serenading the hearts of America.
Yeah.
And to keep the frame of your main femme fatale character crying in the background as credits run.
And it's not, it's not a static shot.
I know.
We're watching her just cry.
It doesn't go static for like a full minute or so.
Yeah, exactly. And then you get the freeze frame, which is always dope. You know, I mean, I think plenty of, lauded film directors have used
that freeze frame. That was some of the most artistic element. That was like the most artistic element of the film was the cry, Phil Collins serenading American hearts and minds.
That hook kicks
and
in.
And then she as she's crying, she looks away from the camera. She's looking at the camera when we hold it.
Yeah.
And credits roll, right? Looking at the camera and or Jeff Bridges.
Yeah.
Beautiful.
Sure.
Jeff Bridges.
Crying, I'm never going to work with this man again.
Oh, my God. Oh,
he just
my God.
Turned in a chunk of shit.
Oh, my God. Oh, my God. Oh, my God. She looks away. You're like, what is she looking at?
Yeah.
Where is she going? What is she just thinking about life? And then, boom, looks back at the camera, freeze frame.
Bam.
Phil Collins.
Yeah, it was money.
Gorgeous.
That was money.
It's pretty fucking good, dude.
Yeah, that was great, for sure. But we're talking about, like, moments here.
I mean, you have a chase sequence and a you know.
Right, a musical interlude, and then a credit song or whatever that's, like, sick. No, I know.
And
I mean, this is not...
And a couple pretty shots that have, like, tone that's interesting, and some very unintentional, so bad it's good.
Yeah.
The Avenue 54 Film Club highly recommends that you go see Out of the Past.
Yes.
And do whatever you got to do to see it. If something's going on in your house...
Yeah.
And you gotta, like, you know, lie to your wife about what you're doing and go hide out in the garage and watch it, do that.
You gotta do it.
If you're not allowed to watch, you know, movies with racy topics because you live in a Christian household that's or Orthodox something or other, you know.
Sneak into the basement somewhere and go watch this movie. For sure.
Avoid against all odds.
Yeah.
That's our double feature review, the first one we've ever done.
Highly enjoyable format, though, doing the double feature, which is very sick, you know?
Yeah.
They can't all be fucking masterpieces.
That's true. And it's the first time I've done a review and bashed it.
Yeah.
All the time.
Yeah. Usually you're not putting yourself in positions to, you know, watch movies that you're just like, well, I don't know about this one.
All right. Well, thank you. Thank you for watching, like, and subscribe some shit. Avenue 54. We'll be back with another review soon.
Hopefully it's a double feature. Thanks for having me, Bob.